Good afternoon. Thank you for joining us today at the Metro North Division webinar. I'd like to welcome everybody. Thank you all for taking time out of your schedule and listening to our program. I'd also like to thank the Metro Division 2020 year-long partners, Chandler Cabinets, DuPont Tyvek and Weatherization Partners, Milgard Windows and Doors, First National Bank Mortgage, Kellymore Paint. We are about to start our webinar, but first, just a reminder, we will be taking questions for this program. Please put any questions you have in the Q&A portion of the screen. You can find that feature at the bottom. Questions will be answered at the end of the program. Without further ado, please help me welcome Rodney McNabb and Evergreen Design Group. Thank you, Rodney. Take it away.
Thank you, Matt. I appreciate it. And thank you all very much for attending. A little history on me first. When I got out of the Marine Corps, after 7 years in the Marine Corps, I went to work in Houston, Texas for a landscape maintenance company. And this was in 92, so it's been a couple years. It was a family-owned company, which my family owned, and it's a guaranteed job coming out of the Marine Corps. And so they started me out as a spray technician. So I was the guy out there with the spray hose, spraying the lawn, killing the weeds, fertilizing the turf, that sort of thing. And it didn't take long for my family to figure out that that probably wasn't the right position for me. They were receiving too many reports of dead grass instead of dead weeds. So they quickly pulled me out of that position and transferred me to become the first sales and estimator for the landscape construction portion of the company. So they were focused on strictly maintenance before. I came in, basically started the construction division for them. And they got me in the right spot at that time. I did nothing but excel. I took on project management roles, managed a few of their offices in Texas. And for a year, I even went to work for a national landscape company. And that company focused on both the exterior as well as the interior landscaping of shopping malls. So I managed about five different states for them. Went on to start my own design, build, maintenance, landscape company in Houston as well. So I played contractor from about 92 to 2005. And then it was in 2005 when I decided I like this design part a lot. So I created Evergreen Design Group, 2005. We've been going strong for 15 years now. The majority of our projects are located in North Texas. I've lived in Rockwall myself, very familiar with the area. So been in the landscape industry since 92. Got a couple years behind me now, and just wanted to provide that little history on me before we got into the subject. And your association has asked me to generally go over some Xeriscape principles with you all. And first, let me say that the word is Xeriscape. It's not Xeriscape, as I've heard many people frequently call it. It's not zero landscaping out there. It's Xeriscaping. And Xeriscaping and sustainable landscaping, sustainable planting, are two terms that are frequently used together, and it's totally understandable that they are. The xeriscaping is a little bit more refined, whereas the sustainable landscaping starts to incorporate more of the organic side of the maintenance as well. Organic pesticides, insecticides, fertilizers, and such. But with xeriscaping, and that's basically what we'll touch on today, is the xeriscaping side of things. The benefits, lower maintenance costs because of lower maintenance required. lower water required, hence lower water costs, and it's better for the environment. So you've got three great benefits there. With you being on the contracting side, typically not too much maintenance involved with your projects, more on the construction. So I understand that the costs are a big factor. So again, savings with costs on the maintenance, and especially savings with the cost on the water usage. So with Xeriscaping, there's basically seven different water-wise principles. And the first one is the planning and design, which basically means put the right plant in the right place. So if we have a shady area over here, we need to put plants that tolerate the sun over here and plants that tolerate the shade over there. Now in the industry, we have another term called microclimates. And basically it goes on the same principle of the types of plants, putting them in the right place. So not only based upon sun type that you have, but also water type. Some plants are very drought tolerant. Some require a lot of water, and most of them are somewhere right there in the middle. So you want to group plants together that have the same light requirements and the same water requirements. All right, so that was the first. Number two, we're going to move on to soil improvement. So basically, soil is critical to healthy plants. The soil will hold the water for the root zones. The soil provides the nutrients to the plant materials. And when a soil can be permeated so that the water trickles down to those root zones as well. Now, in North Texas, we have pretty crappy soils. It's usually a lot of clay, even some rock. So the question is, how do we amend these soils so that they can become useful to the plant materials that we're installing? Well, the first step is to perform a soil test. And you're going to want the soil test to incorporate basically two areas. The first area being turf grass area. So wherever you're going to have turf grass in that area, you'll want to take a soil sample. And then another area we're going to have plantings, you'll want to take a separate soil sample from there. You'll take your soil samples, submit them to a soil testing lab, and then make sure you plan this in advance because it takes a few weeks to get the results back. But what they're going to do is they're going to come back with a report for you. And that report is going to tell you, one, the type of soils that you have, and two, how you can amend those soils so that your plant materials will not only survive but thrive in that area as well. And this is why you need to break out the turf from the plantings, because they have totally different types of requirements. So an example of a result may come back for your turf grass. And they say, all right, well, this is your turf grass type of soil that you have existing on site. We recommend to amend that you blah, blah, blah. You know, add 40 pounds of gypsum per 100 square feet, you know, 2 pounds of nitrogen per 1,000 square feet, or whatever they come back with. And then you'll want to ensure that is utilized, those recommendations are taken into account as you amend your soil. So that was number two, soil improvement. Number three, practical turf areas. So turf grasses in general require a lot of water, a lot of fertilizer, fungicide, insecticide, and regular mowing. We want to, with Xeriscaping principles, reduce the turf areas where practical. Now, in dealing with single-family homes, we of course need to keep a turf area typically in the backyard because most people have pets and they need to have room to go out and do their thing. But there's other areas that can be modified in the sense of not using the turf grass, maybe the front yard, the sides of the house or whatever. And you can incorporate, in lieu of turf grass, bull rock, decomposed granite gravel, some other sort of rock, plants. You can use ground covers, other plantings, or even large mulch areas. But just reduce the turf areas as possible so that they're not requiring so much water and so much maintenance. And then also with turf grasses, you're going to want to select a species that is drought tolerant and works well in your area. For example, a very popular turf grass in Texas is down in the coastal area, in the Houston area as well, might not do so well in North Texas. You want one that again, is drought tolerant and is not going to require a lot of maintenance. Now, for the projects that we design in North Texas, typically we utilize Tifway 419 Bermuda sod. If we're hydromulching a project, we go in with common Bermuda grass. The reason we don't do the Tifway for the hydromulch is because Tifway is not available in seed form, only sod form. But the Bermuda grass has always been there. It's good and strong, and it spreads easily. During a drought, it will brown out, but once it receives that water again, it pops right back up. So it's definitely a proven leader in the North Texas market. Now, a long time ago, we had tried buffalo grass on some projects in North Texas as well. And being that I had worked in the San Antonio and Austin areas, I was very familiar with buffalo. And so we thought we'd give it a shot in North Texas. The problem that we ran into is it was very cost prohibitive. Not a lot of growers of buffalo grass in the Dallas area, so they had to ship it in, and it got very expensive. So again, Bermuda grass is what we typically use. Residences, I'm sure some people are wanting to use the zoysia because the way it feels under the feet. Low maintenance as well. But my experience with it is it's also not very wear resistant. For example, if you have a dog back there in the backyard with turf grass or even just a high foot traffic area, it doesn't pop back and grow back quite as well as what it could if it was Bermuda. Okay, so that was number three. Now we move on to number four, which is efficient irrigation. Being that I'm speaking to a bunch of builders, I know that a lot of times you like to have the landscape contractor design the irrigation system themselves. And as long as they're a Texas licensed irrigator, that's fine. But keep in mind that when you have contractors doing design build, a lot of times they're looking out for their bottom line, understandably so, and may not implement all of the water conserving opportunities that are available. Plus, when you have a third party designing the irrigation system, you can get apples to apples bids from the contractors instead of allowing them to do whatever they feel is the best approach. So I always recommend a third-party designer prepare the irrigation plan before you send it out to bid for your own benefit of the quality system that you're going to get and being able to compare apples to apples. Now, with Xeriscape, we talked about water-conserving measures. I'm sure you're all familiar with rain freeze sensors. Basically, the rain sensor is like a sponge. And when it rains, you like my rain coming down? When it rains, the sponge expands, cuts off the power to the controller so that after a substantial rainfall, the controller is not going to go off again until as that sponge starts to dry out, it contracts, allowing that flow of electricity back to the controller again. And the freeze sensor operates basically on the same measures. There's also a very important component that's called a flow sensor. And what that does is, if you have a break in the piping and water's just gushing out all over the place, or I'm sure you've seen, you drive by a property, the sprinkler system is going, and you see that geyser shooting all the way up in the air because probably the mower hit the head and broke the head. With the flow sensor, it will detect excessive flow like that, and it will shut off that zone, and it will notify you on the controller that it has shut it off, that there is a flow problem. And that way you can fix the problem, because most irrigation systems run early in the morning before people can even see them. So if you have a broken head and your sprinkler system's going off every day, every other day, you're wasting a lot of water out there, but this flow sensor will help conserve that water. There's also, with sprinkler heads, for a couple dollars more, you can pay for pressure regulating stems on the heads, or PRS. And what these do is they regulate the pressure going through the orifice of the spray head. So sometimes you might have too much pressure and they're just missed, the water is misting out. It's not coming out the way that it should. It's uneven distribution pattern. So these PRS heads will help provide the more better distribution for you, because it's regulating that pressure for you as well. Drip irrigation. On all of our projects, unless we're specifically asked not to use it, we utilize drip irrigation for planting areas. And the spray heads for planting areas, I look at it as the old way of doing things. They're not as efficient because, one, they're popping up and spraying. A lot of times they're blocked by the plant. The water is blocked by the plant, so you can't get water on the other side of the plant. Or if they're spraying and the wind's blowing, you're going to lose a good portion of that water to the wind blowing. Plus, it's not distributing the water where the plant needs it the most, which is at the root zone. The drip irrigation provides an emitter right at the base of that plant, so it's getting the water right where it needs it. And people ask me, well, how do I know if the system's working or not? Because you can't see it. It's under the mulch. When you have an irrigation design prepared for your property and they're specifying drip irrigation, they also need to specify the little pop-ups. Now, it's just like the little pop-up spray heads, except you don't have the water coming out of them. Basically, it pops up to show you, hey, this zone is on. Now, if that guy is just slowly going up or only halfway going up, then you know you've got a problem. But if it pops up right away, the system is working fine. So no longer the excuse of, I don't know whether the system's working or not with the drip. Okay, so the importance of design, watering times. As I mentioned a minute ago, most people water in the morning, and that is the best time to water. If you water at nighttime, the water is just going to sit there and make your plants and turf grass more susceptible to fungus. So we don't want that, because then you've got to pay to have the fungus eradicated. Plus, you got to look at it during that time frame as well. And if you wait to water until during the day, then you are losing a lot of the water to evaporation. As soon as it comes out, the sun's beating down on it, sucks it right up, and it's gone. Another problem with watering during the day is that when the water is getting on the leaves, the sun's beating down on these leaves, light's reflecting, going to burn the leaves. So early morning, that's time to water. Watering sustainable plant materials. I've had people come up to me and say, Rodney, we want you to design a sustainable landscape plan, sustainable plantings, because we don't want to water. And I'm like, well, you're still going to water, especially initially. You put those plants in the ground. In order for the plants to get established, they need water. And they need water regularly. Once they're established, then they become more sustainable in the sense that less irrigation is required. Now, do you still need an irrigation system beyond the sustainability point or beyond the establishment point? Yes, you do. In North Texas area, we frequently have the droughts in the summers, which means the plants are not getting any water from the rain because there is no rain. So we need to have the irrigation system there in place to supplement the rainfall by providing that water, or else you're going to be replacing a lot of plants, as many of you probably already have, even during establishment period. If you're not watering them regularly to get established, you're going to end up replacing a lot of plants, and that adds up in dollar wise. So yes, irrigation systems are very important still, even when you design sustainable plant materials for your site. All right, we move on to number five, which is mulch. With mulch, there's basically two types. You have the organic mulch and the inorganic mulch. And with the organic mulch, there's a whole slew of different things out there. You have the shredded hardwood, which is what we typically specify. You have cedar, cypress, pine bark, compost, native tree, and then you can get into the color dyes, the red, the black, and so on and so forth. And then you have the inorganic, which could be rocks or gravel. In terms of the rocks, typically bull rock, also known as washed river rock, is used. Decomposed granite gravel is also used. Now, in my opinion, which do the plants prefer, organic versus inorganic, is going to be the organic. The organic mulch, as it deteriorates, it adds the organic materials back to the soil. So you're keeping that soil aerated, allowing water to penetrate down to the root zones, allowing the root zones to continue to spread out and so forth. If you're going to use the rock or the gravel, definitely a more of an upfront construction cost than the organic. But it's going to be less of a maintenance cost. The bull rock, you should not have to ever replace. The decomposed granite gravel is just that. It decomposes. So every couple of years, you will need to add a little bit more to it. With both applications, ensure you use a weed barrier as well underneath the gravel to help suppress the weeds. But with the organic mulch, you're getting all those primary benefits. You're retaining the soil moisture. You're slowing evaporation. You're protecting the roots from overheating, and you're help suppressing the weed growth. Depth for the organic, 2 to 4 inches will work. And then that would be for an initial install. And you can supplement that once or twice a year. It really doesn't matter in terms of what the plants are going to prefer. My personal preference is twice a year. Now, of course, you'll go in with half the application if you go twice a year. But one, it just looks fresh again after 6 months of sitting there. So for aesthetic reasons, it looks better. And the other reason, it just helps keep it from becoming a compacted layer of mulch as well. Now with the gravel, you know, the decomposed granite gravel, typically about 4 inches compacted. And then the bull rock, you can do about the same, about 4 inch. Okay, so that was number five, which was mulch. We now move on to number six, which is low water use plants. So again, choosing the right plants for the right locations and choosing plants that are hardy to the area, that are proven sustainable plant materials for that specific area. Frequently new plant species will come out. For example, the roses that came out a few years ago, there's several of the different varieties that came out, the climbing, the I forget all the different types, but now we've learned that they get a bad fungus on them in the North Texas area, and some jurisdictions won't even allow us to specify them anymore. So when that shiny new plant material comes out, it's not necessarily going to be right or hardy for the site. So give it some time, make sure it works for the area first before you specify it and use it on your projects. And again, the water requirements for plants go anywhere from, you know, low to high and everywhere in the middle. So you're going to want to choose those that have the low water requirements. You're not going to want azaleas or ligustrum or something that's going to have a high water requirement in a Xeriscape property. So that was six. Now the last one, number seven, appropriate maintenance. So don't scalp the lawns. Some people are under the impression that, hey, if I cut my lawn really low, that's less frequently I have to mow it. But what they don't realize is cutting their lawn really low is making it more susceptible to insects, diseases, and burning out. Because you don't have the blades there. Here I go with the hand gestures again. The blades to shade the root zone from the sun, because they were cut off. And when a plant, turf grass, stresses out, that's like telling, hey, chinch bugs, hey, fungus, come on over. We're stressed out. Come on over and keep us happy for a little while. So that's just inviting problems. So please do not scalp your lawns. We had talked about the difference between the Xeriscape and the sustainable landscaping. The sustainable landscaping part comes in a lot with the maintenance. So there's organic fertilizers, seaweed, fish, and yes, it smells. And then you have organic pest control, I believe corn gluten meal is used as a pre-emergent, and vinegar for existing weeds, and then insecticides. There's all types of organic stuff as well. But again, in my opinion, those organic type products require more frequent use to be effective, and also require more of you and your eyes on the property looking for potential problems. But you've always got that option. You can go straight organic, you can go straight synthetic, you can go right in the middle as a combination of the two, whichever your goal is that you're going for. When it comes to watering a lawn, we talked about when you should be watering. And you also want to avoid runoff. So don't water areas too long where water is just running off and going in the storm sewer system. You don't want to overspray on concrete areas, sidewalks, driveways, that sort of thing. And one point I didn't bring up earlier about the irrigation, another component are variable arced nozzles. So most irrigation spray heads have nozzles that do a set pattern, but there's also variable arced nozzles that you can use where you can adjust that pattern based upon the location of that head, which is awesome because you avoid the overspraying in that aspect as well. Okay, so we've covered the seven principles of xeriscaping briefly and quickly. Now, at this time, I will ask, what questions do you have for me?
Doesn't look like we have any just yet.
Okay. I did such a fantastic job that no questions. Is that what it is?
Sounds like it. Okay, here we go. We have one question. It says, what is the cost to get the soil test?
Okay, let me... About how much more time do we have? A couple minutes?
Yes, you've got about 30 more minutes if you want them.
Okay. Don't worry, guys. We're not going to take that long. Let me share screen. Okay, is my screen visible? No.
No, not yet.
Host disabled participant screen sharing.
Let's see. All right, give me just a quick minute.
Okay. While she's doing that, there are a couple different places out there where you can send the soil test. I have provided a couple resources for plant materials in North Texas, as well as the lab that I have utilized in the past. And then we'll click on that screen as soon as she gives me access, and then we can take a look at their website.
Okay, it looks like you should be able to share your screen.
Host disabled participant screen sharing. Okay, now it's not happening. Let me just come over here. Copy, come back. There you go. That's who we've used. The pricing depends upon how much information you want. It can be, I don't know, it's been a while since I've done it, but maybe $75 a sample or something like that. Plus, of course, you're shipping it to them. All right, let me try the share screen again. Nope, still disabled. But if you just Google that, throw that company name in your browser, preferred search engine, then that'll pop up. All right, do we have any other questions?
Okay, you should be all set.
All right, trying it again. Hey, there we go. Okie doke. Okay, so here's their website. You'll want to go over here towards the soil. Click on the soil and then scroll on down. Tells you the different types of testing that they do. Phosphorus, potassium, magnesium, soil pH, all the different stuff that they test for, which is quite a bit. And then also, sampling procedures. So they tell you how they recommend that you take that soil sample as well, how deep you go down, yada, yada, yada. And then when you're ready, you just come over right here, submittal forms and price list. And then scroll on down, turf and nursery soil sample submittal form. And then it'll download a PDF. And there's the form that you do. Now, I know he had asked cost. Let me see if they're showing any costs on here.
Hey, Rodney, it looks like everybody's just seeing your document and not the actual website that you're going to.
Huh, okay.
There we go.
Okie doke. So let me go back. We'll do this real quick. So first you'll go to soil. This shows you what all that they're testing for. All a whole bunch of different stuff. And we come back up, best sampling procedures. So on that page, they're giving the recommendations on how you need to take the sample. And then submittal forms and price lists. And you just scroll on down to turf and nursery soil sample submittal form. You click on that link, it'll download a PDF for you to fill out and send to them. I'm not seeing any pricing on here. Let's see. No. So you'll need to get with them on that pricing. But again, I think it was like $75 or something like that. Again, depending upon what all that you're looking for the soil test results. A couple of these other links that I've provided on here, Creekside Wholesale Nursery is one of the nurseries that I have frequently used as a contractor. They supply all over Texas, but they have a lot of good plant materials. Click on that, go to their availability, and then a PDF of their availability. And it will show you a lot of the plants that they have. I mean, here's some agaves. Cactuses, and then typical plant sizes that they're coming in from them, a bunch of different type of yuccas and such. So this is a good source for some plant materials. Let me go back. Plants for Texas. This will give you a lot of good info on plants that are sustainable in Texas. Again, not necessarily the North Texas region, but in Texas overall. So it gives you a picture, a thumbnail of the plant, in this case a rosemary. Click on it. There's some more information about the plant and then larger graphic as well. City of Dallas tree list. Now, this is very beneficial because of the information they provide. So a large tree, a Fantex ash, they give you the botanical name, scientific name, overall height at maturity, overall width, and keep in mind, these are just guesstimates, water requirements, medium to low, how far you should space them apart, and any comments as well relating to that specific tree. So doing a Xeriscape landscape, we're going to look for those with water requirements that are low and utilize those in our design. And look at all this you've got to choose from. So there's a whole bunch of good info for trees in North Texas. And then shrubs for North Texas, same thing, just a link with some photos of different types of shrubs that work well in the North Texas area. Not necessarily drought tolerant, but just some shrubs up there. Click on it, on the Abelia, gives you all kinds of info, drought resistant for low water situations and so forth. So that's another great resource. Turf grasses, this one is provided by Texas A&M. Talks about different varieties. We have the Bermuda grass. This seashore, I have no clue what that one is. The buffalo, St. Augustine, zoysia, centipede. So it gives you a lot of good info on the plant, on the turf grasses. Now, Living Earth is, they were my supplier as a contractor for soil, for mulch, and for gravel. So you just go to products, and in this case, see, they have the mulch, compost, and soil, sand and gravel, rock, stone. We'll just select the mulch, and you'll see the plethora of different mulches that you can choose from. Fine shredded hardwood is what we typically specify. A lot of times with the native hardwood mulch, what I see is it's still too new, which means it's releasing too much nitrogen, so we really don't use that too much. These mulches that are dyed can stain your concrete as well, so we don't use those. Native hardwood, red, brown. Okay, so there's all kinds of different mulches. Sand and gravel. All right, pink sand. Black star gravel, that's really nice gravel. A little pricey, so you'd only want to use it in focal point areas. Rock and stone. All right. So there's the bull rock, chalk rock, looks like that's pretty similar to the bull rock, since bull rock is just Houston only. Mexican beach pebbles, again, a very nice product, but also pretty expensive. And then there are types of composts and soils as well. So planting mix, you just click on that. And they'll give you the stats of what it is. From what I remember, their planting mix is a combination of a third bank sand, a third compost, and a third topsoil. All right, so that's a great resource for you up in North Texas as well for those items. And then we've already gone over the lab's website. Any other questions?
Okay, looks like we have a couple more questions. One is, how long should you wait before mowing newly laid Bermuda sod?
Don't mow it right away. You definitely want to wait till it's probably 3 or 4 inches high. You want it to have some depth before you do that initial mowing. Plus, you want to ensure that it has taken, meaning that the roots have already attached to the soil as well. And that brings up another good point too, is with new turf grass areas, you don't want to apply any sort of weed control for the first year, because those roots are still too shallow and you're going to burn them up. So that's something to keep in mind as well.
Okay, looks like we have one last one. It says, does your company provide a service for soil testing?
We do not. So that would be the A&L Labs link website that I showed a few minutes ago.
Okay, looks like that is all the questions we have. Matt?
Hey guys, thank y'all for attending the meeting. Very informative. Rodney, thank you so much for taking time out of your schedule to do so, sir. That was a lot of information. Likely we'll be doing some work around my house with that data. If you want to come over and help, you feel free, sir. Guys, y'all enjoy the rest of the week. Eventually we will get back to America 2.0. I look forward to seeing each and every one of you guys. Thank you so much for being a part of the Dallas Builder Association. All of your efforts are very helpful in the industry as we all move forward towards the same goal. Thanks a lot. Have a great week.
Thank you. Bye-bye.